Hey everyone, welcome to our podcast today on International Women's Day, where we will be talking about allyship, equity, and good role modelling behaviours. Today we're joined by a fantastic guest, Sue Farr. Hey Sue, thank you so much for joining us today to talk about embracing equity within BAT. We would love to learn more about yourself, so please, if you could introduce yourself to everyone tuning in.
So my name is Sue Farr. I'm here in my guise as Senior Independent Director on the board of BAT. And I've been on the board since 2015. Goodness, how time flies. My professional career was marketing. Spent a lot of time on the client side with companies like Vauxhall, Thames Television, the BBC, and also partly the agency side. And that was full-time, full-on, the usual thing. And then I was invited to join a board as a non-exec. In fact, it was a wonderful organisation called Historic Royal Palaces, and that was in 2007. And I went to see my boss at the time and said, oh, I've been invited to do this. So he was a bit, does that mean I lose some of you? And I said, well, possibly, but you gain, because you gain a different perspective, a different market and all the rest of it. And so I joined the board of Historic Royal Palaces. And then from then, I realised how much I enjoyed the non-exec space, and it brings new challenges, new people, new sectors. And so I gradually over time increased the amount of time I spent on boards as non-exec and decreased my executive time. So goodness, I think I've now been on about 9 or 10 different boards. I have to say my time here at BAT has just been a privilege, if I'm really honest.
And it seems that way too. And if anything, like we see so many women at the moment not going for these type of roles. What made you want to go for a role like this or apply for the role?
Well, I'd seen some of my peers do it. I mean, BAT is a very international organisation, so I can't say what was going on in other countries at the time. But in the UK at the time, the government decided that they'd had enough of the excuses about why there weren't more women represented on public companies. And so there was a period where there was a lot of attention given to it. And it wasn't because they were being woke about it. It was because all the studies, all the academia showed that actually the more diverse the group, whether it's a board or a management board or a team or a department, guess what? The results are better because there's more diversity of thought. And so I thought, oh, I quite like the sound of this. And in the beginning, I was often the only woman, and then obviously didn't get it completely wrong, because then there might be a second and a third. And I realized that actually it was a different way of contributing, and it was fascinating. So, but why do more women not apply? It's really interesting. A woman will typically go look at the spec and think, oh yes, I can do that, I can do that. Oh, I'm not sure I can do that. Don't have enough experience there. Maybe I shouldn't apply. Whereas typically a man will go, oh, yeah, I can do this.
Yeah.
Yeah. True. Yeah. This is perfect. I'm perfect for that. So there's a self-belief thing, I think.
Yeah.
And then maybe there's more of a questioning that some women put themselves through. And I think to hell with that. Come on. Go for it.
I agree.
And nobody's perfect for, you know, there isn't the perfect candidate for each role. So if you tick 8 of the 10 boxes, it's got your name on it. So I think they're the reasons. And I think the more can be done to encourage whichever minority it is, that they can be in the right place at the right time and do a good job, the better.
And it's actually really great the way you've actually just said, you know, you were trying to push that bias away from yourself and say, actually, I'm going to go for it. What do you feel then the biggest, apart from that as being one of the differences, what do you feel the other big differences between men and women going for board level roles?
I think that's the main one, to be honest. And I think there's the other issue, which is, am I ready for this? Is my organisation going, my executive organisation going to let me take it on? Am I going to be able to find the time? So there's some practicality around it.
Yeah.
But I think the more women who now have taken this path, and the more we all talk about it and encourage others to go forward, the more people realise this is a really, you benefit, the company benefits, your existing company benefits. And for me, it's just a way of continuing to really be challenged by my working life.
Yeah, and to continue to grow, right, as individuals.
Absolutely, Absolutely.
So I think that's such a great point. And to do that, some form of good role modelling should come through some way, right? Did you have any good role modelling in your life?
Yes, because marketing is my professional background, there are a number of organisations whose whole purpose is to support women in marketing and communications. And certainly here in London, I can't speak for other cities, many of my cohort joined those sorts of organisations, and it was perfectly part of our everyday lives to go to conferences, to go to hear people speak, to invite people into our own offices to act as role models and share their stories. I was at a wonderful marketing services organisation called Chime Communications for many years. I was chairman of their marketing services division, and it was quite boisy. And I thought, I want to do something about this. I set about creating a women's network in Chime, and it was called Grapevine. And I found a way to invite prominent, successful women to come and talk to women in the Chime group. And I say, listen, I don't want you to sugarcoat this. Talk about your careers, but talk about the things you've learned. Talk about the things you wished you'd known then that you know now. Talk about your failures, because we've all got them. And be honest. That was my tell your story, but be honest. And it encouraged the female cohort in Chime. And it became, over the years, it really became a powerful thing. And it got to the point where, and you'll love this, Karen, the younger men coming through said, well, we'd like to come and listen to these women. We just see them as success stories. I mean, they're role models for us too. Please, can we come?
Yeah.
So like, oh, well, hang on a minute. We're not sure you're invited. And then we thought about it and we thought, yeah, actually, that's another step forward. And so we had some Grapevine events for anybody who wanted to come and some Grapevine events that were just still for the female cohort, because there were some women who felt, because it was very interactive, who felt uncomfortable asking questions or sharing their own, what they saw as weaknesses in front of their male colleagues. I was so proud of it. It was a wonderful thing to have created.
And it sounds so amazing as well, right? And especially when you've now seen men wanted to join a women's network.
It's quite funny.
I can't tell you how many times a man comes and asks me, there's a women's network. Why do I need to join a women's network? But the whole point of joining a network is to grow your learning and understanding, right?
And understand it from different points of view, because sometimes, you know, we're all in our own lane.
Yeah.
And actually, you want to venture out.
Yeah.
And hear what it's like for other people, because that's the way you learn.
And become good role models itself as well, right, when you do that. And that's a really great way to actually segue to the next part, which is when we look at mentoring and coaching and so forth, when we look at that formality for women especially, how about yourself? Have you gone through that yourself? Have you gone through mentoring coaching?
Like many of us, I didn't really know what a coach would do. And I figured out that the best way for me was to see this woman. I saw once a month. It was always Fridays at 4 o'clock, and I'd save up something that I was wrestling with. I'd save up a problem. I'd save something that I couldn't quite work out.
Yeah.
And I'd talk to her about it, and she would come up with not solutions to the problem, but other ways to think about it, or other areas to consider. And I'd go away with a sort of an action plan, and it was practical and helpful, and I realised then how important coaches and mentors can be. And then as I've progressed through my career, there are other organisations. There's something called the Marketing Academy.
Oh, nice. Okay.
In the UK, and it's a genius idea. They ask senior practitioners in marketing to mentor people coming through the system. And so I did that for many years, and you meet outstanding young people. And it's a privilege to be asked, because actually you come out of it brimful of new ideas, and hopefully they've learnt as well. So learning from experience and somebody sharing with you and somebody that you think is so senior that they can't possibly have made mistakes, share their mistakes. You think, we're all human.
Yeah.
You know, we all get it wrong sometimes. Phew. Yeah. What a relief.
And it's so true, because I feel like there's a lot of stress, especially when I speak to people individually, they talk about the stress of being perfect. And then that actually, there's a lot of this thing called about imposter syndrome. Have you ever experienced imposter syndrome? And if you have, could you give an example of what that would look like?
I don't think I've thought of it in that way until it started to be talked in that way.
Yeah.
So looking back, I think my experience of that was goodness, can I take on this responsibility? Can I solve this problem? So that was my version of it, I suppose, which is you'd confront something and you'd think, this is a big ask. Can I do this?
Yeah. Actually, I've not heard of that type of form of imposter syndrome, actually. So it's quite enlightening to hear that. And I'm just thinking about the people listening in today. What advice would you give them if they are feeling like they're an imposter?
If you ask for help, by and large, people step up and they lean in and they give you that help. Yeah. And you will find that you're not the only one.
Yeah.
You know, everybody, I can promise, even in this organisation, in the BAT, I can promise all the regional directors, all the management board, all the executive board, all the board, all of us will have had times in our life when we've thought, I don't know how to do this.
Yeah.
And it's ask for help. Yeah. Don't struggle on.
So true. And you said at the start where you've been here since 2015, and when we look at BAT in general and see like where we, you know, what is the great changes that you've seen happen at BAT since you've been here?
Well, the reason I joined BAT was because it was made very clear to me, and I wouldn't have joined otherwise, by the way, that they were on a journey towards a better tomorrow. It wasn't called that at that point.
Okay.
But the big change in the last 6 years has been the pace of that change.
Right.
And the speed and the commitment and the faith and the passion that the senior leaders in this organisation have to deliver on that promise. You'll know, because you're in HR, you'll know the huge success that Hain and her team have had hiring in senior people from the non-tobacco industry. And that comes back to diversity of thought.
Yeah.
We've needed those diverse experiences to work with our brilliant and existing teams to take us forward. And that's, in a way, the best example of diversity that I think I can talk about today.
I always believe that diversity is some way or form, but inclusion comes from diversity in general. So as long as you feel included, the diversity is going to flourish as well too. So I feel like it's such a great balance for sure. What's the biggest challenge you're seeing that BAT might be facing, or that one thing that we should be looking more into?
Having worked, and still, I'm still on 4 other boards, and having worked on 10 boards now in total, I've seen the way other companies come at this. And it gives me enormous pride to be sitting here today and say that actually I think BAT is ahead of the curve. The targets that you've set, the programs that you've got in place, the fact that it operates across the world in so many regions and in so many companies and is delivering tangible results. So the board is on this, and we get regular presentations and reports on the progress. And the targets that were set were challenging.
Yeah.
And some of the results have been outstanding in terms of the numbers of the nationalities, the ethnic diversities, the female diversity through the organisation, rising up to the top. It's the result of a lot of hard work and a lot of belief. And again, the belief is not just because it's the right thing to do, which clearly it is for society and for business and for the lives we all lead, but it delivers results. It delivers commercial results.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't a, oh, shall we have a look at this because it would be a nice thing to do.
Yeah.
But don't forget, it delivers a commercial imperative. It delivers a commercial result. So it's a win-win. Now, having said that, there isn't a company in the world that's got it completely right.
Yeah.
And there are still some obstacles.
Yeah.
We're challenging on it because we just want to do more and more and more, because this isn't a project.
No.
This is part of the culture of a successful company. And so the programs just have to stretch into the future. They'll look different.
Yeah, for sure.
The emphasis will be different.
For sure.
The initiatives will be different.
Yeah.
But I feel proud, actually, that we're doing so much.
Yeah.
And the fact that we're now recognised externally for that,
yeah,
that's not why we're doing it. Of course it's not. But to see that recognition and to see how important that is to people in the company.
Yeah.
And people who are thinking about joining the company.
Yeah.
That's very important too.
Yeah. It's not just for making people feel like they're included as well. It's also that business gain as well.
Exactly.
For anyone.
Exactly. And in the end, that, you know, for the gains, for the naysayers,
yeah,
it's that business result that will finally make them realize that they're just wrong.
That's it.
And get with the program.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And then if I think about that amazing story that you gave around, you know, doing that employee network and that sofa that grew from there, and then you said men were becoming allies, is there anything we can go into that a little bit deeper in?
I want the men in this company to advocate for diversity in this company. because it's just much more powerful.
Agreed.
That would be my call for action.
Agreed. And that's such a beautiful way of saying it as well, right? Because we know that Kingsley Wheaton, who's the chief growth officer, he's a sponsor for our Women at BAT network.
Brilliant.
And that shows good role modelling and great leadership behaviours in itself there, right? Because we need more individuals there that will be really the allies, really, to help support the movement.
Because the business will be better for it.
For sure. And people, the inclusion and the diversity will just flourish within that space. Thank you so much, Sue, for your time today. I think we've covered so many great areas: allyship, good role modelling, great inclusive behaviours, and actually what call to action we need to do as individuals within BAT.
Well, hopefully that'll set some conversations going and people will find things of interest in the podcast. So thank you very much. And happy International Women's Day!
Happy International Women's Day!